These parts represent a large part of a dealership's income through the replacement and the maintenance.
Essentially, this group of parts is a visual representation of the profits that the auto industry doesn't make when they sell an EV1 or an EV in general. I can actually identify a lot of these that didn't get used on the EV1 program. You know, oil filters you need 4 times a year. That was probably the most prominent thing, along with the several quarts of oil every time.
I didn't enjoy working on internal combustion engines just due to the fact you got so dirty. And working on EV1, I'd basically go home looking like this. Servicing the EV1 was pretty simple. It came in about every 5,000 miles. We'd put it in the air. We'd rotate the tires, add washer fluid to it, and send it back out on the street. It's amazing. Look how dirty I've gotten just in handling this stuff. It's kind of sad.
In order to sincerely market a clean car, you have to suggest that your core product is dirty.
Don't you wish you had an electric car? One that you could charge up at home or at work for nickels while helping decrease our demand for oil from unstable, unfriendly nations? And not some little golf cart. I mean a regular-sized car that needed almost no maintenance, was perfect for commuting, outperformed most gas-powered cars, and generated none of the pollution that threatens both our personal and planetary health? In 1996, General Motors made such a car, the EV1, and leased it to several hundred drivers who quickly fell in love with it. But by 2004, GM discontinued the EV1, forcibly took them back from drivers, and crushed them into scrap. Why would GM, which is now little more than a bloated corpse, have discontinued a car that would help solve so many pressing problems and was clearly the industry's future? This is the central question of Chris Paine's important, informative, excellent documentary, Who Killed the Electric Car? While most people think of electric cars as a far-off fantasy dependent on yet-to-be-invented technology, Who Killed the Electric Car reveals that not only are they possible now, they were a reality almost 100 years ago, when most of the earliest cars were electric-powered and were considered preferable to their loud, smoky cousins. The modern electric car came about because of California's Zero Emissions Vehicle Mandate, which was passed in 1990. It dictated that car companies had to have a certain percentage of electric cars in their fleets. While the auto industry resented the mandate, most prepared to comply, and the EV1 was part of that effort. But as soon as the EV1 became available, a coordinated campaign began to kill it. GM made it needlessly difficult for drivers to lease the car, then launched a ridiculous ad campaign that seemed designed to confuse and discourage potential buyers. But none of this could dampen the enthusiasm of those drivers lucky enough to lease an EV1, which included celebrities like Tom Hanks, Alexandra Paul from Baywatch, and even crazy-ass Mel Gibson. As GM tried to discontinue the EV1, they put themselves in the surreal position of trying to prove that there was no demand for a car that had a waiting list a mile long and was loved fiercely by drivers. When the EV1 was killed for good, GM took the highly unusual step of taking back every EV1, giving drivers no option to buy the cars, even after they collectively offered GM $1.3 million to purchase them. Even stranger, GM then proceeded to destroy every EV1 they had repossessed, as if to hide the evidence that electric cars had ever existed. That's right, a car company that would rather destroy hundreds of perfectly good cars than sell them to willing customers. Something must be up. So in true mystery fashion, Who Killed the Electric Car takes the very clever step of producing a list of 7 suspects who might have caused the EV1's premature demise. Was it the Bush administration, which was run by former oil execs and helped car companies sue the state of California over the zero emissions mandate? Was it car companies who stood to lose billions from the costly maintenance and replacement parts dirty gas-powered cars require? The list of suspects goes on to include oil companies, consumers, electric car batteries, and the California Resources Board. Let's just say there wasn't a lone gunman on this murder. But one of my favorite parts of the movie is its merciless smackdown of hydrogen fuel cells, which I always knew was a scam. You don't have to be a genius to realize that no one would buy hydrogen cars unless there were stations to fill them. And no one would build the stations unless people bought the cars, which are outrageously expensive. But the film goes further, explaining what it calls the 5 miracles that must occur for fuel cells to become commercially viable. Let's just say don't hold your breath. Fuel cells were just a scam, so the Bush administration and car and oil companies could pretend they were part of the solution, not profiteers off the problem. It's important to remember that for decades, the US auto industry has fought tooth and nail against raising fuel economy standards, claiming that producing more fuel-efficient cars would, get this, hurt their business. I mean, can you just imagine the trouble GM would be in right now if it was selling more hybrid and electric cars instead of their genius idea of doubling down on giant SUVs and the preferred transport of douchebags, the Hummer? With the collapse of both the auto and financial industries, can we finally, once and for all, dispel the ridiculous notion that companies always know what's best for consumers, let alone themselves? As Who Killed the Electric Car points out, it was laws, not car companies, that required catalytic converters to get us off leaded gasoline, made seatbelts mandatory, and increased fuel efficiency by 50%. We need to tell car companies that we want clean, fuel-efficient cars now, and we need to elect officials who will pass the laws forcing them to do it. That may be the only way that we can make the electric car a reality, for the third goddamn time. I'm Jonathan Kim, and this is a ReThink Review.